Hi everybody, this is Dr. A, and I'm bringing you a short series of three videos on Labware, and we're going to start with reagents in water. So a reagent is defined as any substance that's used to produce a chemical reaction. We use a lot of reagents in the lab, especially in chemistry. And in highly automated clinical laboratories, very few reagents are prepared by the lab staff. They are purchased from the manufacturers, and they come in kits or reagent packages, and they're just loaded on the analyzers as is. And in many cases, only water or buffer needs to be added to a prepackaged reagent. And I would say even at that, most of the time, if water or buffer or something needs to be added, it's actually done on board of the analyzer and the analyzer does it. Okay, so chemicals do have varying grades of purity. There are analytic reagent grade, ultra pure reagents, and chemically pure reagents. Those are all the best for lab use. The specifications for analytic reagent chemicals are established by the American Chemical Society, and the labels on the reagents will indicate their grade and a percentage of impurities, and then any technical data information that you need on, you can find them on all chemicals. They'll be located on the safety data sheet for that chemical. Okay, so let's talk about water. So water is the most frequently used reagent in the lab. Labs generally require reagent grade water. What is that? It's water that is suitable for use in a specified procedure, and it will not interfere with the specificity, the accuracy, or the precision of the assay procedure. So for example, if you were trying to analyze some trace metals in a sample, you would not want to use tap water because maybe it has some lead from lead pipes in it, right? So lab water does need to have the inorganic and organic impurities in water removed before analysis. So your inorganic impurities would be things like lead or, you know, other metal ions or minerals and things that are found, you know, naturally in water even. And then your organic impurities are going to be things like maybe bacteria or pesticides, herbicides, and things like that, or maybe even fecal contamination. So all of that needs to be removed before analysis. So CLSI, the Clinical and Laboratory Standards Institute, will list categories for water, and they include clinical laboratory reagent water, often abbreviated as CLRW, special reagent water, SRW. Also, there is instrument feed water, water supplied by method manufacturer, autoclave and wash water, and commercially bottled purified water. The basic parameters that will differentiate these types of water are going to be the microbiological count, the pH of the water, its resistivity, its silicate content, its particulate matter content, and its organic content. The basic specs for clinical lab reagent water are 10 CFU or less per mil for the bacterial contamination, a resistivity of 10 megaohms at 25 degrees Celsius as dispensed, a final filter of a minimum of 0.22 microns, and organic impurities at less than 50 parts per billion. There are also different types of water, so they can be classified as type 1, type 2, and type 3, and I think there's even a type 4 as far as purity is concerned. So type 1 reagent water is the most pure. It is considered ultra pure. It has a resistivity of greater than 18 megaohms per centimeter. It is used in the preparation of standards, buffers, controls, in quantitative analytical procedures, in electrophoresis, toxicology screening, high-performance liquid chromatography, gas chromatography, cell and tissue culturing, mass spec, and any trace element instrumentation. It must be used immediately after it is produced and it cannot be stored. So usually those instruments that need it or whatever it needs it, there's a feed that, you know, feeds the analyzer so that it can use the top one ultra pure reagent water. Type 2 reagent water, the resistivity needs to be greater than 1 megaohm per centimeter. It is used for qualitative chemistry procedures and for most procedures that are done in hematology, immunology, microbiology, and other clinical test area. Now, clinical laboratory reagent water can now be used in place of type 1 and type 2 water for most applications. Type 3 reagent water, the resistivity is greater than 4 megaohms per centimeter. It is produced using reverse osmosis, which removes 90 to 99% of contaminants. It is used for some qualitative lab tests, such as general urine analysis, glassware rinsing, media prep, feed water use, and other non-clinical lab use. Feed water use means that it can be a water source for the preparation of type 1 or type 2 water. It can be used for washing and rinsing lab glassware, but depending on the use of the lab glassware, it probably should be given a final rinse with either type 1 or type 2 water or clinical lab reagent water. And type 2 and 3 water can be stored in borosilicate glass or maybe polyethylene bottles, but it should be used as soon as possible to prevent contamination with airborne microbes. There are two general methods that are employed to prepare water for lab use. There's deionization, distillation, and there's also really a third one, which is reverse osmosis. We're going to talk a little bit about all of that. So the methods of water purifications are filtration or prefiltration. There's the water is run through a filter, and then the pore size in the filter material could be things like charcoal and other, type of filters. The pore size can vary. Can also be produced by distillation. I'll show you a graph on how distillation happens, or by deionization. So deionization removes ions. So the water's run through a column and it removes all the positive ions, and then a different column, it removes all the negative ions. And water can also be purified through reverse osmosis. I'm going to show you again a graph on that, but it's using a selectively permeable membrane. And then there's also ultrafiltration and nanofiltration, again referring to the filter and the pore size and what it actually is filtering out. So to produce reagent grade water or clinical lab reagent water, you usually need a combination of purification methods. Not one is just not enough. So most labs use a water purification system that they purchase, right? And that system combines a pretreatment, usually a filtration of some sort, then a reverse osmosis step and a deionization step of some sort. And sometimes even with another final filtration or ultrafiltration, depending on what is needed. So again, as a reminder, distillation, water is heated to boiling, the vapors are going to rise. And as the vapors rise, they're going to be cool, and they're going to be caught here, and the cool vapors will be fed down here to the other area where they will collect, and that removes a lot of impurities, because things that are too heavy to go up in vapor then will stay behind here and will be in the flask here at that's being heated. And reverse osmosis, the principle is it uses water pressure through a semi-permeable membrane to remove contaminants in water, and the water flows in one direction with the dirty water going in and clean water coming out, and it uses the water pressure that's already in the system, usually like in the pipe system, to create the pressure. So that's basically the principle for reverse osmosis. So there you go. So again, there are many brands of water filtration system, but every lab will have one. Some may have one that's dedicated to specific analyzers, but you should also always be able to get water from that to dispense to use, maybe in reconstituting some calibrators or something like that. So anyway, so that wraps up reagents and water, and I thank you for your attention.